Good morning, children. Today I am going to take the last topic of chapter 3, kinship, caste and class. The topic is the view of historians regarding the Mahabharata. Children, if you look through the sources cited in this chapter, once more you will notice that historians consider several elements when they analyze text. They examine whether texts were written in Prakrit, Pali, or Tamil, language that were probably used by ordinary people, or in Sanskrit, a language meant almost exclusively for priests and elites. They also consider the kinds of texts. Were these mantras learned and chanted by the ritual specialist, or stories that people could have read or heard and then retold if they found them interesting? Besides, they try to find out about the authors whose perspectives and ideas shape the text, as well as the intended audience, as very often authors keep the interest of their audience in mind while composing their work. And they try and ascertain the possible date of the composition or compilation of the text, as well as the place where they may have been composed. It is only after making these assessments that they draw on the content of text to arrive at an understanding of their historical significance. As you can imagine, children, this is a particularly difficult task for a text as complex as the Mahabharata. We are going to start with the language and content. Let us look at the language of the text. The version of the Mahabharata we have been considering is in Sanskrit, although there are versions in other languages as well. However, the Sanskrit used in the Mahabharata is far simpler than that of the Vedas or of the Prashastis discussed in chapter 2. As such, it was probably widely understood. Historians usually classify the contents of the present text under two broad heads: section that contains stories, designated as the narrative, and the section that contains prescriptions about social norms, designated as didactic. These division is by no means watertight. The didactic sections include stories, and the narrative often contains a social message. So, children, generally historians agree that the Mahabharata was meant to be a dramatic, moving story, and that the didactic portion was probably added later. The text is described as an itihasa within early Sanskrit tradition. The literal meaning of the term is "thus it was," which is why it is generally translated as history. Was there a real war that was remembered in the epic? We are not sure. Some historians think that the memory of an actual conflict amongst kinfolk was preserved in the narrative. Others point out that there is no other corroborative evidence of the battle. If we talk about the authors and dates, who wrote the text? This is a question to which there are several answers. The original story was probably composed by a charioteer bard known as Sutas, who generally accompanied Kshatriya warriors to the battlefield and composed poems celebrating their victories and other achievements. These compositions circulated orally. Then from the 5th century BCE, Brahmanas took over the story and began to commit it to writing. This was the time when chiefdoms such as those of the Kurus and Panchalas, around whom the story of the epic revolves, were gradually becoming kingdoms. Did the new kings want their itihasa to be recorded and preserved? It is also possible that the upheavals that often accompanied the establishment of these states where old social values were often replaced by the new norms are reflected in some parts of the story. We notice another phase in the composition of the text between c. 200 BCE and 200 CE. This was the period when the worship of Vishnu was growing in importance, and Krishna, one of the important figures of the epic, was coming to be identified with Vishnu. Subsequently, between c. 200 and 400 CE, large didactic sections resembling the Manusmriti were added. With these additions, a text which initially perhaps had less than 10,000 verses grew to comprise about 1 lakh verses. This enormous composition is traditionally attributed to a sage known as Vyasa. Children, all of you know, Mahabharata is being written by Lord Ganesha and narrated by Vyasa. Children, let's speak to the next topic, excavation of Hastinapur. The Mahabharata, like any major epic, contains vivid descriptions of battles, forests, palaces, and settlements. In 1951-52, the famous archaeologist B.B. Lal excavated at a village named Hastinapur in Meerut. Was this the Hastinapur of the epic? While the similarity in names could be coincidental, the location of the site in the Upper Ganga Doab, where the Kuru kingdom was situated, suggests that it may have been the capital of the Kurus mentioned in the text. Lal found evidence of 5 occupational levels, of which the 2nd and 3rd are interest to us. This is what Lal noted about the houses in the 2nd phase. Within the limited area excavated, no definite plans of houses were obtained, but walls of mud and mud bricks were duly encountered. The discovery of mud plaster with prominent reed marks suggested that some of the houses had reed walls plastered over with mud. For the 3rd phase, he noted houses of this period were built of mud brick as well as burnt bricks. Soaked jars and bricks drained were used for draining out refuse water, while terracotta ring wells may have been used both as well and drainage pits. Was the description of the city in the epic added after the main narrative had been composed? When urban centers flourish in the region? Or was it a flight of poetic fancy which cannot always be verified by comparisons with other kinds of evidence? Consider another instance. One of the most challenging episodes in the Mahabharata is Draupadi's marriage with the Pandavas. An instance of polyandry that is central to the narrative. If we examine the section of the epic that describes this event, it is evident that the authors attempted to explain it in a variety of ways. Children, present-day historians suggest that the fact that the authors describe a polyandrous union indicates that polyandry may have been prevalent amongst ruling elites at some point of time. At the same time, the fact that so many different explanations are offered for the episode that polyandry gradually fell into disfavor amongst the Brahmins who reworked and developed the text through the centuries. Some historians note that while the practice of polyandry may have been seen unusual or even undesirable from the Brahmical point of view, it was prevalent in the Himalayan region. Others suggest that there may have been a shortage of women during times of warfare, and this led to polyandry. In other words, it was attributed to a situation of crisis. Some early sources suggest that polyandry was not the only or even the most prevalent form of marriage. Why then did the authors choose to associate this practice with the central characters of the Mahabharata? We need to remember that creative literature often has its own narrative requirements and does not always literally reflect social reality. Now let us discuss the last topic of the chapter, Mahabharata, a dynamic text. Children, the growth of Mahabharata did not stop with the Sanskrit version. Over the centuries, versions of the epic were written in a variety of languages through an ongoing process of dialogue between peoples, communities, and those who wrote the text. Several stories that originated in specific regions or circulated among certain people found their way into the epic. At the same time, the central story of the epic was often retold in different ways. And the episodes were depicted in sculpture and painting too. They also provided themes for a wide range of performing arts, that is, the plays, dance, and other kinds of narration.